A very good morning to all of you. Good morning, respected chairpersons here. I think there's a slight difference in the article title that has been given to me. And this is actually, we don't treat diabetes as much. It tends to be more. And this is called as common soil hypothesis, where the risk factors are shared by both kind of article diseases. So it is said that, previously we used to think that is about 3 to 5% more chance of having 3 to 5 times more than what you call instance of heart failure in those patients who got diabetes. But it is much more than what it is from this slide what we are learning. This is an old classic slide. Now, if we look at the kind of manifestations what diabetes patient has with regards to what you call is complications, number one is the more common thing is peripheral vascular disease, and this is followed immediately with heart failure. Most of us actually we think that is a coronary artery disease, but it is not so. In fact, the commonest presentation after the peripheral vascular disease and diabetes is heart failure. There's a very high incidence of this heart failure among the diabetics. In fact, if you look at what you call this heart failure in among the patients with diabetes, the etiology is not necessarily ischemic. In fact, the people who do not have ischemia do also have a high degree of chance of developing heart failure. So it is two-pronged, both by ischemia as etiology and non-ischemic etiology as well. Now, there is a beautiful article or beautiful paper that's been published by Fatten and as well as Paulus in European Heart Journal in way back in 2011 when they showed that when they analyzed patients who have come to the clinics for a period of 5 years and they systematically saw them with that TMT was negative, and then they have actually also analyzed whether they have symptoms of ischemic heart disease. When they said there's no ischemic heart disease symptoms for them, but TMT was negative, when they actually systematically examined them for presence of any heart failure, and also they systematically evaluated by echocardiogram, they found about 2/3 of them had heart failure, both in terms of reduced ejection fraction, also by preserved ejection fraction. So this is a very high incidence of heart failure among the patients with diabetes mellitus and needs to be recognized in most of us as a cardiologist. There is a hand-in-glove relationship between the development of heart failure and the glycemic control. The worse the glycemic control, the worse is the chances of having a heart failure among the patients with diabetes mellitus. Well, the paradoxic fact is that when you treat hyperglycemia, when your glycemic control is achieved, but it need not translate into decreased incidence of heart failure. That's what really bothers us. Why is it so? Maybe in the subsequent slides, we probably will see them. Now, worst of all, it is not just necessary to have diabetes to have a heightened incidence of heart failure. Even those people who got dysglycemia in the form of what you call a pre-diabetes, they do have a high incidence of development of heart failure. So it develops heart failure dollars much more before they are labeled as diabetics. So this is to be also noted as an important fact. Now, when we see a patients with diabetes in our clinics, when they come with any physician or a cardiologist, it's important to see the telltale evidences which make them probably have higher chances of having heart failure by virtue of having some other risk factors like being increased whenever they have advanced age, female sex, obesity, and patients who have got renal dysfunction and also hypertension, and these are the ones who are likely to have more HFs. And even the landmark trials which have shown that those patients who are included in the landmark trials of heart failure, that for the both preserved ejection fraction as well as reduced ejection fraction, you can see the high incidence of diabetes among them. That means to say wherever there's heart failure, there's high incidence of diabetes as well. Now, why are we so much bothered as a cardiologist regarding diabetes and heart failure? This is because the very bad prognosis that a person has when diabetic has heart failure. We all know that a heart failure when it's there, there is 50% mortality in 5 years when those patients have just simply heart failure. When diabetics and heart failure are together, the 5 year mortality is even more. In fact, 70% of them don't live after 5 years. So this is the heightened mortality among the patients with diabetes and heart failure. So as a cardiologist, we need to actually know how to recognize it, and how to actually put them into a proper perspective with regard to treatment. Now, when we are trying to avoid the heart failure treatment diabetics, it is just the same that we have a what a classic treatment for heart failure, nothing more different as far as the heart failure molecules are concerned. We know the most of the drugs which are used heart failure, like diuretics, ACE inhibitors, ARB, beta blockers, aldosterone antagonists, and statins do actually have an equal amount of equal amount of benefit among them. In fact, the diabetes do actually benefit with each of those molecules when they are put into action for the control of heart failure. At the same time, even the latest drug like ARNI, when you see the sacubitril valsartan was involved in the trial, for the paradigm heart failure trial, it also showed that a significant decrease in the mortality and all-cause mortality, cardiovascular mortality and hospitalization when it was being given to diabetes patients with heart failure. So nothing different with regards to what you call the treatment as far as the heart failure drugs are concerned. But when we are trying to look at the hypoglycemic agents which are being employed to get the glycemic control, is there a difference in them? That's what we need to know about it. Now, we have a host of these drugs, which actually Dr. Anuja has already spoken to us, but none of those drugs, when they're involved in the trials, had mentioned about heart failure. Heart failure was never what you call a endpoint for these trials. Unfortunately, it is not so in most of the drugs. And worst of all, when you have seen the data, analyzed the data from those trials, which each of these molecules involved, most of them had no effect in decreasing the heart failure, or worst of all, some other drugs like pioglitazone, sulfonylureas, even insulin, the kind of conventional insulin, has also produced bad outcomes as far as the heart failure is concerned. So this is what bad thing about the hypoglycemic agents which we have all these days. Fortunately, we have a couple of drugs which we're going to talk about in the next few slides, which probably are the right drugs to be used. Now, as insulin is one of the classic molecule that is being used in in patients with diabetes, we must also know that insulin is also not a simple drug. In fact, it increases the chances of heart failure among the patients with diabetes mellitus. This is because it actually causes a heightened stimulation of beta 2 receptors in the case of myocardium, and that causes a heightened increase in the heart failure. One has to remember this fact that insulin is not a benign molecule when it's to be given as a hypoglycemic agent. And we have a host of information about this kind of insulin being increasing the heart failure among the patients with heart failure from the landmark trials like Valhep trial. We have was Atmafis trial, GC heart failure trial, and Corona, where they have compared those patients with heart failure with insulin and those patients with heart failure and diabetes without insulin take, with insulin administration. There's a host of difference in the outcomes. Those people who had heart failure and diabetes with insulin therapy did much worse. Now, we have the two drugs we have three drugs which are now got called as SGLT inhibitors. These SGLT inhibitors have shown in two of these trials, as the EMPIRIC trial as well as CANVAS trial, a significant decrease in the heart failure. EMPIRIC trial has gone a step ahead in trying to show not only the decrease, the heart failure hospital admissions are also all-cause mortality as well as cardiovascular mortality in a statistically significant way. And this significant decrease in the cardiovascular mortality was not achieved by decreasing the atherosclerosis or myocardial infarction. Rather, it was achieved only because they decreased the heart failure. So this is what we have seen in EMPIRIC. And coming very close to the other trial, the canagliflozin with the CANVAS trial, which included also patients with established cardiovascular disease and also those patients who did not have established cardiovascular disease. There again, we found a 33% equal amount of reduction in the heart failure when this drug is given in comparison to placebo. And the third drug, we have declared TME58 trial, which is the dapagliflozin. The trial is not yet actually published, not yet read in any other conferences, but top-line results are available. In this top-line results, we have one important thing is this is a large study extending beyond the 5 years, and then we have 17,000 patients which are involved in this, both patients with established cardiovascular disease as well as those patients who do not have established cardiovascular disease, and they showed equally better outcomes as far as the heart failure is concerned. Again, the declared top-line results show, although there is not much of difference with such a significant difference in the MACE, but definitely it has showed a statistically significant decrease in the heart failure. So these three molecules, as a class effect, when given for the glycemic control in diabetes patients, the main effect was the decrease in the cardiovascular mortality by decrease in the heart failure. Looking at these impressive results now, as a cardiology, we got very, very interested in these molecules. We are also trying to know when these molecules are employed to those patients who do not have diabetes, will they do the same kind of what you call good effect in patients with heart failure? We have four trials which are running now. We have, very soon they are going to be published. The Emperor R, which is empagliflozin with reduced ejection fraction, Emperor P with empagliflozin with preserved ejection fraction, dapagliflozin with DAPA heart failure and deliver, are going to be available to know this fact. The preliminary results seems to be that EMPA is doing great in with regards to what we call heart failure patients when given, even if they don't have diabetes. And now presently, to conclude my talk, I would like to say the recommendation is that the patient with heart failure with diabetes must have the same kind of standard treatment like others do, but diabetes do actually have a much more to call better outcomes with these with the conventional molecules that are being used for heart failure, and they must be given the benefit of this. I'll take another half a minute. Unless contraindicated, metformin must be given the first drug, because metformin is a neutral drug. There is some evidence to show, not from the randomized clinical trials, but from the what you call a observational trial, that metformin does have some kind of good effect, if not some kind of worsening of heart failure. Thalazoxanes must be avoided in patients with diabetes heart failure. Beta blockers also should be included in the armamentarium treatment of heart failure with diabetic patients. Although beta blockers are known for their what you call dysglycemic effect, but the amount of good they do in decrease the mortality is far exceeds the harm they do by producing a dysglycemia. In fact, if you look at what you call the percentage of reduction in the mortality among all the molecules, number one will be beta blockers, because they reduce mortality by almost 40%. In adults with type 2 diabetes mellitus, when they have glycemic control is not achieved with conventional treatment, if they have more than 45 ml per minute of 1.7 centimeter square of GFR, if a SGLT inhibitor should be added if they have a established heart disease or high risk for developing heart disease. And the patients who have got a heart failure, this must be preferentially be administered if the GFR is more than 45. Most important fact as a take-home message is that heart failure is under-recognized in patients with diabetes, mellitus, and then it is missed often and poorly treated, and where effective treatment is available for this kind of what we call heart failure diabetics, when we miss this diagnosis, it's going to be doing a lot of bad thing to the diabetics patients. One important thing is the comorbidities like renal dysfunction must be actually addressed in the patients with the diabetes, because renal dysfunction adds to much more higher mortality among the patients with diabetes mellitus. Fortunately, we have this canagliflozin, which Credence trial, which is going to be, which is now halted because of the wonderful effect on renal parameters, the hard endpoint decrease in those patients diabetes renal dysfunction, and this will be a happy sign in those patients who have diabetes, heart failure, and renal dysfunction. Thank you very much for your attention.